I love pornography. Actually, I actually write for men only, so, and I write sexy stories, so I love pornography. I think pornography is, and I must admit, I think... Yes, I think...
And action!
But it starts off with these two lesbians, and then these dogs, two dogs come and fuck the women over sofas, and then these two men come in, and there's this kind of weird piano music, and then they pick the eels out of the tank and then push the eels up inside the women. And my favourite bit was when the farmer goes off to work and waves goodbye to his wife, and she's quite a buxom looking woman. Then she goes into the pigsty and pulls a pig by his ears, and you can actually imagine like the crew pushing this pig up the stairs, and then she tries to wank this pig off, and I'd obviously never seen a pig's penis before, and it was like the weirdest, tiniest little thing. And there was a woman wanking a horse off, and it actually comes over her. And I mean, I think that's enough. Yeah, I see that one film, and that's enough probably.
La place de libération est très mauvais, mais de le jeu de une vacance publique. La place de libération c'est un environnement hostile, mais dans le jeu de la nuit. C'est complet de l'attaque et fast food restaurants. C'est complet de la cul de humanity. Dans la nuit, le rat s'appire et joue dans la poubelle. C'était une ombre de soi-même avant. Nous bataillons beaucoup pour libérer notre nation. Maintenant, regardez ça, c'est apparent dans la place de libération comme nous valons notre liberté. La place de libération, c'est une place de crime dans les heures de la nuit. Rien personne et c'est que pour marcher là pour tout le voleur criminel.
Well, I was waiting to go up on a court case and a friend of mine said, like, if you get a sign and die on the case, like, become sort of mentally ill, the case never comes to court. So I smashed all the windows in the house, stood all the furniture upside down, stuck knives in the walls and all sorts of things. Made it just look as I'd run amok in general, like, but it was all Mickey Mouse. The blokes in a white coat come after the police and they took me away and they banged me up in, I think it was Knatsbury Hospital at the time. And being as a voluntary patient as such, which I was classified as, you was allowed your freedom. And I was out of the hospital every other night, out having a few beers and just going wherever in general. And I pulled some old nurse in there. And at the time, I had a transit van in there with me, with my suits in it and a few other bits and pieces parked out of the way. And I went out with this nurse to the other side of Hartfield somewhere. And I was in the bar there, having a drink. It was like an L-shaped bar. And I looked across the other bar, and there was about four men at the bar. And one of them started nodding like that. And unbeknown to me, he was one of the psychiatrists that had been treating me. Next thing in the morning, the car pulled up, handcuffs on, and they took me away to Leicester Prison. I was put in a strip cell there for about 10, 14 days. And eventually they opened the door, come in, and Mr. Gallagher, as the screw's name was, and he put his hand on my shoulder. I was sitting on the middle of the floor, a blanket, because he had no clothes on. He put his hand on my shoulder and looked down at me like, he said, "You all right, George?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "You're not mad no more, are you?" I said, "I wasn't to start with." He said, "Yeah, we know that." And he said, "Stand up," stood up, and he gave me a cigarette. And the first time I had a smoke for about, I'll say, 10, 12 days, whatever it was, I can't remember. Cut the puffs on the fag, and I hit the deck like a sack of crap. Next thing, I was on the fall landing, suited and booted, like showered, and I was in the prison life.
Okay, I don't know, can I talk about, like, a drug type situation? I was with a friend of mine. We were working at a bar together, we bartended together. We went uptown to cop some drugs, some coke. And God knows what got into our heads. We talked to this guy. We said, you know, come on upstairs, we'll get high, you know. He lived in a what you'd call a tower block. We call them projects, you know, like a council estate in New York. It was up in maybe 110th Street on the west side. And we got up there, and as soon as he opened the door, we realized we were being set up. There was a guy inside with a gun. And we ran down 16 flights of stairs, because there's no waiting for an elevator when you got a guy chasing you with a handgun. And I didn't shit myself, but I could have.
I know some really wicked things, man. I can't tell you that. I've done such bad things. But now, as I'm growing up, I'm getting a bit more a nicer person, but I've done some bad things, I must admit. Well, once I went, when I was at school, our thing was to go to another school, bunk off, go to another school, walk into the school, go into their cloakroom and nick really nice coats from you, and then walk out, and then that's pretty bad, isn't it? We'd have about five of us in a gang would go up to the next school, walk in, leave our old coats and put on their ones, and and then go into Kingston.
I got a free stretch once for a lorry load of whiskey, and it came on top, and I had it on my toes. I got captured, and as I was running, as it happens, I was saying, "Please God, don't let me get caught. I'll never do it again." But I got caught, so he never helped me out that time. And I don't even drink whiskey.
I drink every night. I drink whiskey. In the evening, I'll have a couple. I have wine with my meal. I don't get pissed. I don't fall over. Any longer.
Gin is my hobby. That's it, gin and shopping.
It just gets everyone in the mood, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Well, I think drinking is a fantastic thing to liberate the spirit. And quite often, I like to be kind of outside myself, and I don't take drugs, don't take coke, don't take E, don't take any of that kind of stuff. So I tend to just sort of like to drink half a bottle of vodka or something when I go out, and I love dancing as well. So I like to feel my spirit quite free. And especially when I'm working, I like to be totally uninhibited with my mind. I like to be able to let it free and push it as far as it will go. And alcohol actually really does stimulate me and help me do that.
I had too much to drink last night, and I began to use a language unfamiliar. Don't you think that people should be true to their customers? When Angel sleeps, the world sleeps with him. Sawdust, paper lines the cage floor. Stories from the day before torn up into strips for bedding, the heading, a record turnout for the royal wedding. I had too much to drink last night, and I began to use a language unfamiliar. Don't you think that people should be true to their pets?
I personally do believe there is a life after death, and I think it's a lot happier, and I'll be very happy, basically.
I don't know, it's a roll of a dice, really, isn't it? Yeah, not committed on that one, really. I hope so. But I don't know, not banking on it. Trying to get it done now.
But I'd like to actually believe in life after death, but I don't really. I think once you're gone, you're gone, and you're pushing up poppies. And really, I want mummy, if I die before mummy, I don't want her to spend money on a nice, great big coffin for me. I want them to cremate me and just scatter my ashes in the garden. And with the money that she would have spent on the funeral, I want her to take a nice trip on Concord to New York, because she loves New York, to get over my death.
Okay. Then we're going to be near our sleep.
Old Jamie.
I thought if I would do it, it would be in a car because that's painless, you know, with the carbon monoxide kind of hose pipe in the window thing, you know. But I never actually followed. I never went and bought the length of hose. You know what I mean? But yeah, you know, it got that, I was that depressed.
Well, the last time was in my early 30s and I had a nervous breakdown. And then I had another one, a recurrence, about 10 years later. And I was very, very ill indeed. In fact, I would say that most people who were as ill as I was then don't get better. So for a number of years, I practically was dead. It's kind of a new lease of life, and you're born again, not born again in Christian terms, you're born again in a new lease of life, and you're never bored because everything, life's so exciting, because it's been gone, and then you've got it back again.
I don't think I think about it so much as growing old, but growing up.
Scared the life out of me.
Yeah. I think I can cope with death. Death does not frighten me whatsoever.
Me.
No, it doesn't frighten
depends
me.
Depends how you go. I don't want to go in pain.
No, it doesn't matter how you go to me. Death doesn't bother me, but growing old, no.
Dribbling and that. And so just an old man the other day was dribbling on the tube.
No, it's not even that, just having to rely on other people, you know? And just like, even now...
I think I'd rather be dead than old.
Now I'm getting older, it's getting hard for me to get up on a morning and do things, you know? And like, when you were younger... Oh, it is, and it really scares me.
She's only four.
No, it does, it scares me, but death is cool, man.
I actually haven't really thought about getting old that much, but coming to think of it, I think, you know, I'd like to.
I don't like getting older at all. And time goes by so quickly, and as anybody will tell you, you still feel young inside yourself, but the outside gets old. No, I hate it. I don't want to grow old too gracefully, and I don't want to grow old too disgracefully. It's all somewhere along the middle, because okay,
I quite enjoy getting old. Gets better by the minute.
Cut.